single way.
Let's go.
Take rest, cause the living God is living in my chest. Every day I wake up feeling blessed, and even if I don't, I see it as a test. Cause I was lost until you found me. Now I know you're all around me. Nothing I could ever do separate my love from you. You came to set us free. You came to set us free.
Thankful you ain't drive me in that pit.
Hey, nah.
Saw my soul inside that fam and said that's it.
Grace now.
You never flaking the car winner. I just came to ball with the gold winners. Fast forward, turn to a road runner. Spirit caught me here, go get it. Shed blood, gave me lemonade on this cold bending.
Pick me up.
Always send me Turner, always.
The soul free. Why would I keep this song inside? I think it's time to testify. Throwing my hands up to the sky. Jesus is alive. The praises don't stop. The devil's been dropped. Got some good news coming straight from the top. You saved me from the fire. Lifted me higher. Feeling so good. Gonna sing it with the choir. The king is alive. On the throne. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Why would I keep this song inside? I think it's time to testify. Throwing my hands up to the sky. Praise the name
Jesus.
Cause we're forever saved and death is in the grave.
Check.
Oh, there it is. All right, good morning.
What's up?
Good morning, youth. Good morning, youth. All right. Hey, we just want to welcome everyone to this Sunday service. It's Easter. Jesus is risen. Amen? Hallelujah. Jesus is risen. You know, today, you know, we celebrate that, right? We celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. And but I just want to remind y'all that, you know, it's not just today where we celebrate his resurrection, right? We celebrate our salvation, his resurrection, and his death every single day of our lives. Amen? And so, but today, let's just, you know, really celebrate, because it is Easter, right? The day of our Savior's resurrection. And so, let's all stand. let's all stand. And, you know, before we go into praise, let's just close your eyes and just really think about all that Jesus has done for you in your life. And I want you to imagine the cross, right? Imagine all your sin on that cross, and imagine Jesus taking all of that for you and for me, for all of us, right? And so I want y'all just in this time, just for a couple of minutes, to just really look to God, look to Jesus, and give thanks to him. Give thanks to him. So would y'all just ready your hearts for worship? Ready your hearts for praise. And I'll pray for us. So take this time on your own to just pray to God and just give thanks to him for all that he's done. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the cross. We thank you for Jesus, our one and only Savior. Thank you for the blood that covers all sin. And thank you for the resurrection. Father, you are good and you are faithful. We invite the Holy Spirit in this place. Holy Spirit, would you stir us up? Would you give us the heart of worship to praise you, to sing praises to you, and to glorify you, and to lift your name up on high? Would you be with us? We love you. We thank you. We pray everything in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's read Psalm 23. All right, here we go. The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need. He lets me rest in green meadows. He leads me beside peaceful streams. He renews my strength. He guides me along right paths, bringing honor to his name. Even when I walk through the darkest valley, I will not be afraid, for you are close beside me. Your rod and your staff protect and comfort me. You prepare a feast for me in the presence of my enemies. You honor me by anointing my head with oil. My cup overflows with blessings. Surely your goodness and unfailing love will pursue me all the days of my life, and I will live in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. You're ready to praise God today? Oh, come on. Y'all ready to praise God today? Yeah. All right, let's go. All right, sing it out. Come, let us.
Come, let us worship our King. Bow at his feet. He has done great things.
Amen.
See what our Savior has done. See how his love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things.
Sing it out. come on.
Oh, hero.
Our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God, you have the great deed.
Let's go! You've been faithful.
You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have the great. And I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. God, you do great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain.
Our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God, you have done great things.
All right, let's sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things.
All right, sing it out, come on.
Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable.
Hallelujah, you have done great things. You've done great things.
Yeah, oh, hero of heaven,
you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain.
You have
the great things. Oh God, you do great things.
Yeah. Let's give Him praise. Hallelujah. Sing it out, come on.
Remember those walls that we call sin and shame. There were like prisons that we couldn't escape. But He came, many died, many rose. Those walls are over now.
Yeah.
Remember those giants we call death and grave. There were like mountains that stood in our way. But many died, many rose. Those giants are dead now.
You believe it? All right, come on, let's sing it out. This is our God.
This is our God.
This is who He is. He loves.
Remember that fear.
Remember that fear that took our breath away. Faith so weak that we could barely pray. But he heard every word, every whisper. Now those altars in the wilderness tell the story of his faithfulness. See this truth, come on. Nobody but Jesus. Right, come on, sing it out. Come on. Who rescued me from that grave?
Yahweh, Yahweh. Who gets the glory and praise? Nobody but Jesus.
Right, come on.
Who rescued me from that grave? Yahweh, Yahweh. Who gets the glory and praise? Nobody but Him. This is our God. This is who we are.
Of his resurrection, come on. Then on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Yeah! Oh, tremble, death.
Pastor David, and give him your wisdom. We pray for life group and our teachers. Please continue to bless the teachers. We pray for this week's Unify. Thank you for giving us time to be together during the week. We pray for the missionaries out in the world. Please give them strength physically and spiritually. Please give them support so that they will be able to share the word with those who don't know you. We pray for pastors, adult staff, Stuco, praise team, and media team. We pray for anyone who is sick in our service. Please heal them with your mighty hand. We pray all of this in Jesus Christ's holy name. Amen.
Guys, can we turn to each other and say, Happy Easter? Can we say that? Happy Easter. Happy Easter. And let's do one more time. Can we turn to each other and say, Jesus is alive? Can we say that? Amen. Amen. So today is Easter Sunday. We're glad that you guys are here to worship God. And we believe in the risen God, right? Jesus is alive and he's amongst us and he's guiding us in our lives. And today I want to share, we have some visitors who are visiting here with our service today. We want to recognize them and welcome them to our service. So could you stand up if I call your names? Joshua Im. Where's Joshua? There's Joshua. And then we have Yerim Wu. Where's Yerim? Wu Yerim. And then, could you keep standing up? So we have Joshua, we have Yerim, and then we have, where's Oliver? Oliver Yang. And then we have Blake, go. So we have four. Can we welcome them to our middle school worship? Cool. Give them a big round of applause for them. Welcome to our service. You guys can all sit down. Thank you for coming to our service. And also, I want to share with you today that Where's Sophie? Sophie Chang, where are you? Can you stand up? So Sophie, she completed 4 weeks of newcomers training with me. And starting today, she'll be assigned to a life group class. And who are in 7B? Can you guys raise your hands so we correct? Can I see you? 7B, who are in 7B? So make sure that she'll be joining in your class. So her name is Sophie. Make sure to take care of her as you guys go to our life group today. So what's gonna be our question for today? So what question would you most like to know the answer to? What is the question? Was that a question? What question would you most like to know the answer? Okay, that was the question. All right. Can we all stand up and then move around, ask this question around, and then come back and continue worship? Make sure that no one's staying alive by themselves alone.
No. So good morning. Today we have a very tight schedule, and so we'll be moving forward. I'm very excited today because we have a lot of newcomers because it's Easter Sunday. But not only newcomers, we have 5 students who are getting baptized, and we'll be hearing from them. But before we do, let's sing our Bible song, and then I will call up one at a time. So are you ready? Here we go. And high school students, do you remember this?
Yeah.
Okay, let's see. Okay, here we go. Good boy, can you turn up the music? 음악 켜줘, okay. Here we go.
Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1st and 2nd Samuel, 1st and 2nd Kings, 1st and 2nd Chronicles, Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, and Job, Psalms and Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, Isaiah.
Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi.
Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, and Romans. First and Second Corinthians, Galatians, and Ephesians. Philippians, Colossians, First and Second Thessalonians. Now it's First Timothy, then it's Second Timothy, Titus, and Philemon. And Hebrews, James. Now it's First Peter, and then it's Second Peter, First John, Second John, Third John, Jude.
So I'm looking, and some of our high school students, you know, since you've sang this song so much with me, you all know it. But some of our newcomers, this is the facial expression. What the heck is this? Like, but anyway, if you start attending our church, we sing the Bible song so that we can memorize all 66 books of the Bible. And so if you are a newcomer, then please try your best to sing along with us. We sing it every single Sunday, and so it shouldn't be too hard after about 6 months, right? We have 5 students, and they're all boys. So where are all the girls? But anyway, but for today, our Easter baptism, we will be having 5 boys being baptized. One is 6th grade, and all the rest of them are 8th grade. I'm really thankful for our students. So as we welcome, can I get a wireless mic up here? Oh, 여기 있네, 여기 있네. No, it's okay, I have one. So as we welcome one at a time, please give them a warm round of applause, right? So let's start off with Ethan Cho. Come on up. Oh, okay. Our media team made a mistake. No problem, man. Just reading. Okay.
My name is Ethan Cho, and I am in 6th grade. I have been attending church ever since I was born. I have been attending New Song Search for 7 years. I want to be baptized because I decided I want to grow closer to God and follow His path. As I was going through the years, I began to grow closer to God and began thinking about being baptized. I wanted to accept Him into my life as my Savior. Another reason why I want to be baptized is after Call and Connect. I learned about finding my true purpose in life that God intended for me. I want to be baptized so that I can trust in Jesus with every decision I make. This is why I want to follow Jesus in baptism. Throughout the years, God uses circumstances in my life to draw me to Jesus. I want to be baptized, so I... Hold on. First one is during winter retreat. I was moved by the Holy Spirit. Second example is my prayers being answered. I had this huge urge to be closer to Jesus. This is how God used circumstances in my life to help me on my journey to be baptized. I came to the decision that Jesus is my Savior over the years, like little by little, like going upstairs. I had been in church not knowing and not caring much about Jesus, but God was slowly turning me into a new person and following His word. Over the course of many years, my faith was increasing like a puzzle, and I was becoming closer to God. Another time I wanted to be baptized was at the winter retreat. I had been moved many times at the winter retreat after worshiping day by day. This is where and when I have come to the decision to accept Jesus Christ as my Savior after winter retreat. There was one verse I remember at a young age, John 3:16. For this is how God loved the world. He gave His one and only Son so everyone who believes in Him will not perish but have eternal life. It helped me know about Jesus and His sacrifice. This whole verse helped me stay to God with my faith. People who helped me on this journey are my mom, my dad. They helped me come down this path of following Jesus by inspiring me. They went to church every week to learn the word of God. Changes in my life after accepting Jesus was that I began to see what knowing Jesus does to people. An example would be a person would act more like a good Samaritan. Another change is that I see the people who need help and I pray for them. These are the changes I see in my life as a result of knowing Jesus Christ. Along my life and the different people and places who helped me along my path to be journeyed to be baptized. This is my testimony of how I came to be baptized. This is how I came to know Jesus and why I want to be baptized. So I can be closer to God with every step I make in my life. Thank you for listening to my testimony.
Let's welcome Eunhyuk Choi.
All my pictures are weird. My name is Choi Eunhyuk. I'm grateful to the Lord for being born into a faithful family. Getting baptized as an infant in my parents' arms and attending church ever since, living a life of faith. I have always believed in God's existence. I trust that He created, helped, protected, and healed me, and He has always been my side. However, I haven't always relied on God entirely. I didn't read God's His word. Prioritized my thought over prayers and lived as if I were in control. Through this testimony, I repent. I choose to get baptized not because of my parents, but from my own heart. Committing to journey with the Lord, my encounter with Jesus, and dedicating my life to Him happened gradually, like building the Great Wall of China brick by brick, where each event led me to dedicate my life to Jesus. One memorable incident from my childhood left a lasting impression on me. During my fourth grade, my favorite class was swimming class on Wednesday and Thursday. One day, I forgot my swimsuit for the class. I haven't forgot my swimsuit several times before, and each time I had to wait in the classroom until the class ended. I was like, my mom never brought it me, desperate to join on the day. However, I prayed like fervently in the restroom with like tears in my eyes somehow. To my surprise, when I returned, my swimsuit was on the deck. This seemingly small event, but like it strengthened my trust in the Lord who answered prayers. I started enjoying praying alone in quiet place. I started Matthew 6:6, when but you pray, go into your room, close the door, pray to your Father who is unseen, then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. In fifth grade, when I came to the United U.S. during a Bible study on Romans 10:13, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, I gained assurance of salvation. The command in Matthew 28:19, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, still remain my homework. Furthermore, my last day of the winter retreat 2023 became a fervent moment of encountering another aspect of God. There was a time for people to share their reflections during the last day of winter retreat. Hardly anyone was coming up, and most seemed to have no intention of sharing, like I too had no intention of speaking. But the Lord kept urging me to go up and share. And I prayed, Lord, I'm really passive, and I have nothing to say. Even like I go up now, I'm not the one. But I felt like we're feeling a sense that Lord was calling me. Suddenly, I remember the story of Moses. Moses was also refused to go to Egypt due to his inability to speak well, but he eventually went and led the people to Promised Land. So, like, I share that I came out because the Lord gave me the heart to speak, even through I'm usually passive. Surprisingly, after that, like, people starting came up little by little, and many testimonies continued long after the scheduled end time. I couldn't help but be amazed at seeing what the Lord has planned. Therefore, I decided to always obey the heart of Lord give me. Even when I think I can't do it, I came to realize that God always has a plan. The main reason I decided to baptize was the Daniel Prayer Meeting USA. Hearing the testimony of adults during the Daniel Prayer Meeting USA deeply moved me. Through prayer, I repented a lot, surrendered my life to the Lord, and resolved to walk with Him. Through the testimony of tenor Lee Young-hoon, despite being a renowned opera singer who eventually canceled a major performance for the sake of worship, chose worship, endured pain and hardship, and proclaimed the name of the Lord, I came to clearly understand the purpose of my life and decided to dedicate my life to proclaiming the name of the Lord. My life goal became not worldly success, but proclaiming the name of the Lord to journey with the Lord. I must die and live according to Jesus who lived with me after receiving baptism. I desire to live a closer life with the Lord. I praise the Lord who was with me yesterday, is with me tomorrow, and is with me now. Amen.
Ian Choi, let's give a big round of applause to Ian.
is Ian, and ever since I was born, I learned God's word and spent my life as a Christian. However, until recently, I didn't truly understand what being a Christian was, or how I could become closer to Christ. Before I truly felt God's presence, I was doubtful, and I did not think or act the way a Christian should. I was ignorant of what God has done for me, and I paid no respect or attention to my Lord and Savior. I saw church as a place to hang out with friends, and I thought of God merely as an unimportant and distant figure. However, God had better things planned for me, and through his will, he transformed me to have a deeper understanding of his word and a personal connection with him. I was lost and ignorant, but God helped me acknowledge Christ as my Savior. I personally met and truly accepted Jesus through the summer retreat of 2023, where I learned that I could be my true self with God and that I didn't need a filter. I realized that God is always there for me and that his love is powerful and everlasting. I prayed for repentance and accepted Christ as my Savior. God also helped me change my ways and become a better Christian through developing a more personal relationship with Christ. Recently, God has shown me many meaningful sermons and Bible readings over time to show me, bit by bit, who Christ was. I felt that I was developing a stronger connection with God and that he was helping me connect with him through the sermons. I came to realize Christ as a powerful factor of my life and that I should serve his will. I believe that through my recent personal connection with Christ, God was telling me to be baptized. It was a step to becoming a true Christian and becoming even closer to Christ. I also believe God paved my path to baptism through my friends and family. My parents and friends taught me more about Christ than I knew originally, and their actions and knowledge motivated me to follow Christ. The devotion to God that my friends and family showed encouraged me to be a more devoted servant to God, and I realized it was my duty as a Christian to show the world that God is my Savior. God gave me the courage and inspiration to be baptized through the Bible verse Romans 6:4. For we died and were buried with Christ by baptism, and just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, now we also may live new lives. God's word inspired me to start a new life through Christ and repent of my former ways and sins. I hope to use baptism as a symbol of repenting my sins and starting a new life with God, just as Christ rid the world of sin and start a new life for all of us. I hope through my baptism I can publicly show my faith to the world and inspire others to believe in God like myself. As Christians, it is our goal to save others who have strayed from God, and I hope that God intends my baptism and faith to inspire others to become Christian as well. I wish to show the world that I have accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior and repented my sins. I hope that baptism can symbolize and show my transformation as a more devoted Christian and the start of a new chapter in my life. God has kept me safe, loved, and has a plan for my life. He has opened a door to a new and faithful life through baptism, and I'm honored to be one of his followers. This is my testimony of how I came to know Christ and why I want to be baptized. Thank you for listening.
Can you raise me a little? Caleb, I changed the mic, it hurt my ear, but... Yes. So every year we have our baptism testimonies, but for our students, even though it may take a while, I think it's really important for you to listen to fellow peers and how they came to meet Jesus and why they're getting baptized. And so we have two more, so please listen carefully, right, to the next ones, right? Let's give a big round of applause to Isaac.
Hello, my name is Isaac Lee, and I'm 8th grade. I wanted to get baptized so I can declare my love and faith to Jesus Christ. I am going to tell you how my life changed after Christ entered my life and my life with Christ now. Before my life with Christ, I was unfaithful and immature. I said sinful things, and I saw church as a checklist and not as a commitment. I would yell at my friends and call them rude names. I would also not pay attention to the sermons and would just play games on my phone. But in the 2022 winter retreat, I heard the pastor's sermon, and I learned that Jesus still loves you, even if you're a sinner. And if you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior and ask for forgiveness, he will forgive you. That day, I accepted Jesus as my personal Lord and Savior and asked him to forgiveness and to be my life every day. God changed me because I can see Jesus more in my life and I can rely on him more. I have a habit of breaking the pocket clip of mechanical pencils. And in the baptism meeting, I broke Ethan Cho's mechanical pencil and I felt bad, and I asked God to forgive me, and I gave him a new mechanical pencil the following week, and Ethan forgave me. I also feel more committed and dedicated, and I trust in God, and I feel him working my life. For example, when the middle school praise team needed a keys player, I knew God was calling me to join so I can use my talents to worship Jesus. When we have practice and play on Sundays, I play with passion and a heart to worship. I want to get baptized so I can publicly show that I am a new person in Christ and become a son of God. Galatians 5:22-23 says, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law." My life after Christ is like bearing the fruit of the Spirit. I no longer say mean things to my friends, and I truly love my friends and family. I have lots of joy and enthusiasm when I play keys on Sunday. I have peace knowing that God is always with me no matter what. I used to pray thinking that Jesus would instantly let my prayer come true, but now I have patience when I pray. This is my testimony of how I came to know Christ and why I want to get baptized. Thank you for listening.
Let's give a big round of Let's give a big round of applause to Nathan as he comes up.
Hello, my name is Nathan Lee. I've attended New Song Church for my whole life. However, that doesn't mean I was a true Christian. I went to church every week until about fourth grade, but was unable to go to church consistently because of golf tournaments. Because most of the tournaments were on Sundays, I wasn't able to go as much as I used to. That was when my spiritual life was at an all-time low. I lived like that for about 2 years, and then COVID hit. Because of COVID, all of my tournaments were canceled for a year. During that year, however, was when I tried to get closer to God. I prayed more, and I was able to listen to the sermons because it was online. I started getting closer to him. However, due to golf, I went to Thailand for about 4 months. While I was there, I didn't listen to any worship services, and honestly, I forgot about God. I was drifting away from God. Yes, I prayed before meals and before I went to bed, but my relationship with God was plummeting downwards. I'd be living without God for about 2 years when my life took a turn for the best. My mom came up to me and told me I would be going to Winter Retreat. At first, I didn't want to go to Winter Retreat, but when my friends told me they were going as well, that was when I got excited. Before we left for retreat, we got to choose what seminars we wanted to take. I chose what plan does God have for me and what is my purpose. After that, we left for retreat. When we got there, we unpacked and we got ready for the first worship service. I wasn't sure what to expect or what it was going to be like. When we got to the worship service, we sang worship songs and then we sat down for the sermon. The sermon was titled, Go and Love Again. The sermon was about Hosea and Gomer. Even though Gomer was unfaithful and unloyal to Hosea, God told him to go back and love her. I believe through the sermon, God was trying to tell me even though I was unfaithful and even though I was an imperfect being, God would still love me no matter what. Fast forward to the final night, while we were singing worship songs, I was truly able to meet God. We sang a song titled, At the Cross. The chorus of the song goes, at the cross I surrender my life. I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, Jesus. That's when God truly opened my eyes. He showed me how much he loved me. He sent his one and only son, and while I was still a sinner, Jesus bled and died for me. That's when I put my faith in Jesus. That was when I prayed and asked him to be my personal savior. I asked him to use me in a way to glorify him. That was when I got saved. After retreat, one of the older retreat group members came up to me and told me how I should get into the Bible. He said being saved was not the end and told me as a Christian, I had to live my life out for Christ. Since then, I've read the Bible every day. One day as I was reading the Bible, I came across a verse. It was Romans 6:23. It goes, "For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord." Once again, reminded me of God's love. He gave us the gift of salvation, the gift that we don't deserve. That's when I wanted to be baptized and declare publicly that Jesus is my Lord and he is my Savior. I want to be born again as a new disciple of Christ, and I want to show publicly that I believe Jesus died, was buried, and rose again from the grave. From now on, I want to live my life out for Christ. I want people to see God through me, and I want to uplift and glorify him through whatever I do. When I took the seminars at Winter Retreat, I learned that you might not know what God has planned for you in life. However, something else I learned is that God truly does have a plan for you, and his plan is best. No matter what God tells me to do, I'll trust him and do whatever he tells me. This is my testimony of how I came to Christ and why I want to be baptized. Thank you for listening.
I think the greatest joy that Pastor Julius and I can have is to see our students come closer and closer and personally confess Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. I have about 13 minutes for my sermon, so I'm going to try my very best to do my sermon as fast as possible. If you have your Bible, please turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 12 through 19. And please stand in the honor of reading God's word. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. So if you memorize the Bible song, you know, it's right after Romans, right? 1 Corinthians. On my Bible, the big one, it's 692. And the seven small one, it's 3:2. 1 Corinthians? It should be in the New Testament. 1 Chronicles, Michael. Oh, 1 Corinthians. 879. 879 in the small Bible. Good, good. Awesome. Please stand with me, and we'll read the verses together. So I'll read verse 12, you read verse 13, and we'll read the last verse together. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 12 through 19. Okay, so I'll get started. For those of you who are looking, right, please find it and then stand with us, right? The resurrection of the dead. But tell me this, since we preach that Christ rose from the dead, why are some of you saying there will be no resurrection of the dead? And if Christ has not been raised, then all our preaching is useless and your faith is useless. And if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is useless and you are still guilty of your sins. Let's read it together. 1, 2, 3. And if our hope in Christ is only for this life, we are more to be pitied than anyone in the world. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. So today is Easter Sunday. And the title of today's sermon is What About the Resurrection? The topic that we're studying for the month of March was sin and death. And finally, we close this topic with the resurrection, right? Can we look at the person next to us and say, Happy Easter! He is risen! He is risen, right? He is risen. Okay, so these are the five topics that we studied for the month of March. And today, we want to get started on Easter Sunday with this question. Which day during the year do you think is most important for Christians, right? So, I'm going to give you a few examples. The first is New Year's. How many think New Year's is the most important day for a Christian? Okay, wait. New Year's is important, man. It's the start of the calendar year, and we all have our prayer marathon, right? Okay, what about Martin Luther King Jr. Day? How many think that's the most important day for Christians? We celebrate liberty, right? What about Independence Day? Okay, good. Okay, what about Christmas? Most important day for Christians is Christmas. As Christians, Christmas is very important, but I would like to say the most important day of the year is Easter Sunday. Right? Today, we are celebrating Easter Sunday. He is risen, right? As Christians, we celebrate an unprecedented event. Today, we're celebrating a once-in-a-history event, right? He is risen. What does it mean? We are celebrating the resurrection of Jesus. What does the resurrection mean? It means Jesus came back to life again, right? He rise from the dead. How many of you came out to Passion Week Prayer Marathon? Okay, how many came out every single day? Okay, good. How many came out during Good Friday? Okay, good. Welcome. Good. Last Friday, we celebrated Good Friday, and Pastor Julius preached a passionate message about Jesus Christ dying on the cross for our sins, right? On Friday, roughly 2,000 years ago, Jesus died and his dead body was taken off the cross and put into a tomb. And it was put into a tomb before nightfall, the beginning of the Sabbath. And so we joined together in the Lord's Supper as we remember Jesus' body that was broken for us and his blood that was spilled for us, right? Spilled for you and me. Okay, now 3 days have passed. On Sunday morning, when the followers of Jesus came to properly clean Jesus' body, they found something extraordinary. What was extraordinary? The tomb was empty. The tomb where they had laid Jesus' body was empty. Not only was the tomb empty before the day was over, most of Jesus' followers had seen him. Jesus was alive. Right? They saw Jesus die on Friday. He was crucified on the cross, buried. But he was living, breathing. On Sunday, they saw him, they talked with him, they touched him. He was alive. Hallelujah, right? Let's read this verse from Matthew 28:6. Ready, set, go. He is not here. He has risen just as he said, right? Okay, now today's passage happens about 20 or so years after this, right? The Apostle Paul visited a Greek city called Corinth, right? And Paul started a new church there with people who came to be followers of Jesus Christ. He spent almost 2 years with the church and the people in Corinth, right? Teaching them everything he knew. And then he left, and today he's writing a letter, right? To the church of God in Corinth. And out of the many questions that the Corinthians had, there was one question that seemed to pop up again and again and again. What was the question? It's this question. What about the resurrection? We can assume a couple of facts. Maybe some of them had doubts about the resurrection. Maybe outside influences caused them to question, is the resurrection real? Did Jesus really rise from the dead? Whatever may have caused some of them to question the resurrection, Paul had an answer. And this is Paul's answer recorded in 1 Corinthians 15, right? So let's dive into the question. What's going on, right? Look at the first verse. But tell me this, since we preach that Christ rose from the dead, why are some of you saying there will be no resurrection of the dead? Paul addresses the main question head on. And what's the main question? There are some people in the church who say, why does there have to be a resurrection? Why? Why does there have to be a resurrection? Why can't Christianity just be a religion without talking about someone just coming back to life? Can we be a little bit more logical and practical in this? Wouldn't more people come to be Christians if we talked about something that's not as overwhelming or that doesn't make sense, like the resurrection, a dead person coming back to life? Why does there have to be a resurrection? And Paul's answer is here. For if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, then all our preaching is useless and your faith is useless. And we apostles will be all lying about God, for we have said that God raised Christ from the grave, but that can't be true if there's no resurrection of the dead. Paul's logic is so simple. And this is his logic. We believe that God the Son, Jesus Christ, came and died on the cross to take away our sins. And we believe God the Father raised the Son back to life. Jesus Christ lives. He's risen. But Paul is saying here what? That everything we believe about Christianity rises or falls on the resurrection. If Jesus did not rise from the grave, if he has not resurrected, then nothing else matters. Preaching doesn't matter. Faith doesn't matter. Hope doesn't matter. Church doesn't matter. What we are doing here at all of you, this is useless. Our faith, our salvation, our eternity, everything rests on the resurrection, right? Without the resurrection, there is no Christianity. This comes to the first point of today's sermon, which is this. The credibility of Christianity rests on the resurrection. Is Christianity true? Is what we teach and preach according to the Bible something we can depend on as the truth? Is Jesus really the Son of God who is also 100% human? Did God really come and die for us? Did Jesus really conquer death and really rise from the grave? The answer to all of these questions depends on whether there really was a resurrection or not. The teaching and preaching of Christians for 2,000 years, it rests on the resurrection. And for 2,000 years, the gospel of Jesus has been proclaimed and taught. And 2,000 years, people have believed that Jesus Christ rose from the grave. Now, if the resurrection was a lie, 2,000 years have been completely wasted. Christianity without the resurrection is useless, right? I hope you can understand that all the teaching and preaching of Christian belief rests on the resurrection, right? Paul elaborates this even more. Look at verses 16 through 19. If there's no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is useless and you are still guilty of your sins. In that case, all who have died believing in Christ are lost. This comes to the second point of today's sermon, which is this. If Christ has not been raised, our faith is useless. Your faith, my faith, all the faith of our students who are getting baptized, it's useless if Christ has not been raised. Our faith rests on the resurrection. For 2,000 years, people have believed in the resurrected Jesus, and Christianity is more than just a belief in a good person who may have lived, right? Christianity is the belief that God himself came, died, and rose. That Jesus lived a perfect life that we couldn't, and Jesus died on a cross as our substitute. He died for you and me. And this Jesus rose from the dead. If there's no resurrection, then our faith is just completely misplaced. There's really nothing to place our faith on. Our faith rests on the resurrection. Our right standing with God rests on the resurrection. Jesus died on the cross for our sin. He paid the price for our sin. He was our substitute in paying the price for our sin. But if he didn't rise again, if there's no resurrection, then Jesus, who said he would rise again, cannot be trusted. Without the resurrection, everything Jesus ever said is called into question. Our forgiveness and right standing with God rests on the resurrection. Not only that, our eternal life and hope rests on the resurrection. If the resurrection is true, then Jesus proved he's the conqueror of death. But if there's no resurrection, his promise is faulty. Our eternal life rests on the resurrection. Media team, can you mute the vocals, please? The vocal mics? Oh, it's like howling. Okay, thank you. Okay, that's why Paul says so clearly in verse 19, right? Let's read it together. Ready, set, go. And if our hope in Christ is only for this life, we are more to be pitied than anyone in the world. If Jesus Christ did not rise from the grave, if he was not resurrected, all that matters is our time on earth. And what does Paul say? We are to be more pitied than anyone in the world. Do you understand what this means? It means if the resurrection is not true, you and me, all of us here, we are to be the most pitied on. People should look down on us. Oh, man. Oh, look at them. They believe in something that's a lie. Hocus pocus. All lies. But today, we celebrate Easter based on the truth, not based on lies. That Jesus was crucified on the cross, that Jesus was really broken for my sin, that Jesus really spilled his blood for us, that he was really buried in a tomb that had a large stone in front of it, but that's not the end. How do we know that the resurrection is real? The Bible says so, yes. But how can we be sure that we celebrate what we celebrate on Easter is not something false? This comes to the third point of today's sermon, which is this. Real testimonies validate Christ's resurrection. How can we be sure that there was a resurrection? How do we know it really happened? Paul talks about three groups of people who saw Jesus resurrected from the grave, right? If there were just three people, then they might have lied, right? But the groups that Paul talks about, it's not just a group of three people. Let's look. Look at these groups. From 1 Corinthians 15, 4 through 8. He was buried and he was raised from the dead on the third day, just as the scripture said. He was seen by Peter and then by the 12. After that, he was seen by more than 500 of his followers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he was seen by James and later by all the apostles. Last of all, as though I had been born at the wrong time, I also saw him. What does Paul say? The first group that saw Jesus was the apostles, Peter and the 12. The 12 apostles saw a living Jesus, and we can trust that they couldn't have been lying. Do you know why? Because immediately after Jesus was arrested, immediately after he died, all of them ran away. They went into hiding. They said, it's over. But on Easter Sunday, Jesus showed up. They talked with him. And if you look at what happened to each and every one of the disciples, all 12, right? All 11 besides Judas, right? Do you know what happened? They all died for him. Would you die for a lie? No. And I don't think the disciples, the apostles did either. They stood in the face of persecution, faced execution, and they said, go ahead, kill me. But I cannot deny Jesus because I know he is risen, right? The second group that Paul talks about is the 500 followers. Paul says in verse 6, Jesus was seen by more than 500 of his followers at one time, right? 500 witnesses. Can you imagine how many people are in this room? How many do you think? About 110, 120-ish, right? 500, five times the people in this room saw Jesus. Whoa! Right? Paul is saying, if you don't believe me, there's 500 people who can back me up, right? You think 500 people are going to lie about the same thing? No, right? Impossible. And would these 500 people give up their lives for something that's false? No. Would you? No. And neither did these 500 people, right? The last group that Paul talks about is himself. He says, I saw Jesus alive. And you have to understand that the Corinthians knew Paul very well. When Paul is writing this letter, the Corinthians, they knew Paul. They lived with Paul. They shared life with Paul, right? And the Corinthians would have read Paul's letters and thought about Paul's life. And everything that Paul taught, everything that he lived, it had to be true because Jesus had come to life, right? But this isn't the end of the evidence. Churches all over the world today, we celebrate Easter, right? Everywhere today, Christians gather in church to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We are here today to testify to a living Jesus. I've met him. I felt his presence. I know he's alive. Have you? Do you know he's alive? I hope you can understand what the resurrection of Jesus Christ means for you. It means our sins are forgiven. The resurrection means Jesus was good on his promises. He promised he would rise again, and he did. Therefore, his entire teaching is valid. I am forgiven. You are forgiven. I am free from sin and its penalty. Since Jesus paid for my sins, I am now right with God. I love our baptism testimonies and how each of our students confess that they are a sinner, right? Because Jesus died for me and he rose for me, now I can have a right place with God, right? God accepts me. The grave is empty. Jesus is alive. Death has no hold on Jesus. He has conquered death. And if he says, if I believe in him, I can have eternal life as well. If I believe, then by him, through the name of Jesus, through his overcoming death, I can also have eternal life. Our future is secure. Did Jesus rise from the grave? Yes. You bet he did, right? And what about the resurrection? Everything matters about the resurrection. And for all of us, I hope you can say that yes to these questions, right? So I'm going to ask you, and I want to hear your voice. Do you believe there was a resurrection? So weak, man. Do you believe there was a resurrection?
Yes.
Do you believe Jesus?
Yes.
Do you trust him?
Yes.
Do you believe he rose from the grave for you?
Yes.
Okay, I'm going to invite our praise team up, right? To come up, right? And we're going to review these points together. Let's read the main points together. Ready, set, go. The credibility of Christianity rests on the resurrection. If Christ has not been raised, our faith is useless. Number three, real testimonies validate Christ's resurrection. The last song I want to sing today is Oh Praise the Name, right? Oh Praise the Name is a song that speaks of the cross, powerfully capturing the depth of God's love as stated in Romans 5:8. God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. It's a story that's as relevant today as it was 2,000 years ago. It's his story. It's our story. It's my story. It's your story. It was real then, and it's real to me now. And I pray that today, it's real for you too. Right? Easter weekend is a one time of the year when people all around the world pause and take time to consider Jesus and what they believe about him. Who he was, what he did, the life he lived, his death, his resurrection, all that happened after. And I love that this song tells a timeless story. It's the story of the cross, his resurrection, of the greatest love story in history. So let's all stand together and let's all sing this last song together.
And drenched in tears,
They laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone.
Sunday, he is risen. Lord, just as we saw through our scripture passage that Paul wrote to the church in Corinth, what about the resurrection? Everything, our faith, our hope depends on the resurrection. But God, we thank you because we believe in Jesus Christ who is not in the grave anymore. He is risen and he is alive today and he is able to conquer all of our fears, all of our depressions, all of our weaknesses. And Lord, so on this Easter Sunday, may we celebrate today on the Lord Jesus Christ rising from the grave and being alive, being with us, even present here during our worship. Father, would you strengthen all of our students as we go into our life groups? Would you bless the time that our students have with their teachers? And Father, we pray for today's baptism. We pray for our 11 students getting baptized. As they publicly declare their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, may it not just be a ceremony, but may it truly be a day where they start their journey strong in their faith. That Lord Jesus, you walk with them every single step of the way. That just as we die with Christ when we go into the water, we declare that we rise again as we come out of the water. And so, Lord, I pray that today will be a special day for our students, and may it be a special day for all of our New Song United as we celebrate together and our students getting baptized and publicly declaring their faith. We thank you so much for today, Easter Sunday. May we continue to have the joy and peace and love that comes from knowing that Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, is alive and is with us every single step of the way. God, we thank you. We love you. We pray all this in Jesus Christ's holy name. We have a couple of announcements today. I'm going to be really fast. We have Easter baptism today at 1 o'clock in the main chapel. So please come, right, and celebrate with us, right? These are the 5 students from middle school. These are the 6 from the high school. They'll be sharing their testimonies during the high school service, right? And so please celebrate with them. Summer missions, today's the last day, right? And then we're going to finish. So if you are still debating, oh, you know, I don't know, I got to ask my mom. Okay, I'll ask your mom today because it may pass next week. Don't come to me and say it's you know, because it's finished, right? This is for youth, right? This is for the additional locations, right? Guatemala, Harrisburg, and Dominican Republic, right? Okay. Fun night we're having this Friday, so please come out, right, to have fun, right? We'll say this together. Ready, set, go. Celebrate Easter. He is risen. Have a wonderful Sunday. If you're getting baptized, please come to the front, right? Please come to the front if you're getting baptized today, right? And let's sit in the front row. Thank you. Everybody else, have a wonderful Sunday. Bye-bye. Music, please.